A check-in with Bernalillo County District Attorney Sam Bregman, who most of us know as a criminal defense and civil rights lawyer, and a dad of a certain ball player, and a Democratic Party leader, of course. The governor appointed him to the new position in January. New Mexico in Focus correspondent Russell Contreras caught up with Mr. Bregman to ask why he decided to switch sides in the courtroom. I want to hear that, and how he plans to address persistent high crime here in Albuquerque.
Sam Bregman, thank you for joining us here today. We appreciate it.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
To start off with, you've had a successful career here in New Mexico as an attorney, former prosecutor. What in the world would drive you to take this department, take this position in a prosecutor's office, the biggest city in one of the poorest states in the country, a department that's had a lot of troubles through the years, to say, I want to take this? What's going through your mind?
Well, you know, given this opportunity by the governor was a great honor. And I got to tell you, the reason I decided to do this was, number one, I love this community. I've raised a family in Albuquerque. I've been in the criminal justice system for 30 years as a lawyer. And this city has a crime problem. There's no doubt about that. That's plain and simple. And the idea that I could somehow make a difference and give back to my community for the wonderful opportunity I've had to raise my family here, and the fact that I love Albuquerque and I want to help, and that's really why I'm doing it.
Did you have any reservations? Because you were a successful defense attorney, you've gone against many prosecutors. I've seen it in action. That you're actually going to step over to the other side and start going after criminals. Was there anything in your mind saying, wait a minute, I have to change my mindset. Can I do this?
No, I have to tell you, my first real job as a lawyer was being an assistant district attorney in this very office many, many years ago. And I look back throughout my entire career, and that was probably my favorite job I ever had, because I felt like I could make a difference every day. And so I went off into private practice. I have had a successful career there. But this was an opportunity that I'm like, you know what, I know this criminal justice system. I know how we need to collaborate together as a community to change the crime situation in Albuquerque. So I'm all in.
Just a few years ago, we were at 30-year lows on crime. Like everyone else, we started upticking on violent crime and property crime. From your perspective, before you got in here, what did you think was driving the crime in this city?
Well, in the last few years, it's fentanyl, it's drugs. And it's unfortunate. We have also a huge gun violence problem. Guns are very accessible all over the country. And I'm a supporter of the Second Amendment. But at the same time, we have people that have no business having guns. We have teens, we have juveniles driving around with guns, with these extended magazines with 50-round barrel. Our drum clips, it's just, it's terrible. But I think in large part, it's fentanyl and it's drugs, and we've got to get a handle on that. That's the underlying reason, I believe.
Now, there have been a lot of critics that say our bail system is also something that needs to be reformed. A few years ago, we were on the other way, where it was hard to get bail. You could go into jail for a small crime and not have the money to get bailed out. Now we've gone the other way, where some critics say we're releasing folks to it. From your perspective, what is the problem now?
Well, let me just back up for a second. I agree with what you explained as the issue before, and that is that people were not getting out just because they didn't have the money for bond. And that's why I supported bail reform at the time. But common sense tells us that if someone, for example, and this is a recent case, if someone has been convicted of killing another human being, and they have done their time but are now charged again with homicide, there is no way that person should be let out pre-trial. They should be detained until trial takes place. And I've got to tell you something. I was very much of an advocate for rebuttable presumption, what they call rebuttable presumption, that says basically that individual I just described, there should be a rebuttable presumption that it's not safe for the community to let him out while pending trial. And so We are working together. We'll continue to work together. We weren't successful in the legislature on rebuttable presumption, but that's okay. I'm not someone that's going to complain about the way things go. I want to look forward. And we are working with the judiciary, all the stakeholders in the judicial system, to make sure that this community is safe, because that's the number one priority, is that people are not only safe, but they have a perception that they are safe, because both those things are very important to have a livable community.
Now, some critics will say that proposal that was before the legislature, there was some constitutionality problems with that. Do you agree with that?
No, I don't, but it's okay. We have a lot of lawyers out there that have differences of opinions. That's why we have cases the way we do, and that's why those kind of issues go up to the Supreme Court. I would have liked to have seen that case be presented to our state Supreme Court to see. Listen, all I'm asking for is to do the same thing that the federal system does. The federal system has basically a rebuttable presumption. And let's be clear, in no way am I advocating changing the presumption of innocence all the way through a case. However, there is a time when you can look at someone's record and you can see their conduct and their newly charged conduct and realize there is no reasonable condition that we can let that person out where the community can be safe.
Now, you're in a unique position. You both defended officers and you both defended clients who were victims of civil rights violations by officers. So you're going in a unique position. Now that you're a DA and you're looking at the totality of where we are with our policing, is there still reforms that the police department needs in order to be safe, fighting crime, but also honoring civil rights and really monitoring its excessive force behavior?
You know, everybody's civil rights should be a paramount concern for everybody. And when I say that, it's very broad, but civil rights are something that I really hold dear to my heart. I have represented people who've had their civil rights violated, but I'll also say something right now about law enforcement. There is not a tougher job in this country than being a cop. It is so hard because what they have to deal with on the street, and then they're second guessed afterwards, right? They're second guessed both in a criminal case or whatever force they thought was needed to use at the time. So my hat's off to every law enforcement officer out there. And 99.9% of them, I think, do one amazing job with how tough that job is. At the same time, we've had DOJ in here over the last few years, and I think the police department has taken a lot of steps for the better. But at the same time, it's not something that I'm overly concerned with as far as a police department in whole. We always will have, in whatever industry we're in or whatever occupation we're in, we'll have some bad apples here and there. But overall, our police, every day we should be thanking them for what they do in this community.
So you don't believe there's a structural problem? You believe it's...
I don't believe there's a structural problem right now, no. I think we always need to be concerned. We give someone a badge and a gun, and that, with that comes huge responsibilities. But I believe for the vast majority of all police officers, they care about this community, they want to protect this community, and they're doing one hell of a hard job every single day.
Why did you only want to do this for 2 years? I know you didn't want to think about the politics of running for your re-election, but for you to implement some of the things you want, it's going to take someone to follow you after to have that same, to buy in. Why would you only go and do this 2 years?
Well, listen, I want to focus on doing the job. I think the best thing I can do is get up every morning as I am, energized because I love this job. Getting up, working with prosecutors, working with all law enforcement in a collaborative way, getting the DA's office working together with APD, with the Sheriff's Department, with State Police, with all of our federal law enforcement officials, and with the U.S. Attorney's Office, for example, working together to grind it out and solve this crime problem. And I'm not focused on politics in the future. I'm focused on doing this job right now, the absolute best I can. And I'm trying to move the needle. And when I say move the needle, you're not going to stop crime tomorrow. But what we can do is put processes in place in this office and throughout the law enforcement community in Albuquerque to really start to try and get a handle on the gun violence, to get a handle on the fentanyl crisis, to make sure we don't have kids in schools with guns. Those kind of issues I really enjoy working on.
Now, everybody's going to have a report card after your 2 years about how Sam Bregman did, but how are you going to judge yourself after those 2 years?
You know, the job of a prosecutor is to do justice. And it's not to get so many convictions. It's not to handle so many cases. It's to do justice on every single case. And I believe my opportunity to teach young prosecutors as well as other prosecutors in that office what justice means. I will judge my success by how well our prosecutors are doing, not in convictions, but presenting a good case to a jury and letting them decide. I will judge, of course, it would be great if we saw some crime numbers go down. I anticipate we will. I anticipate that we are making a difference. We're going to go after these drug traffickers. We are going to be relentless in our pursuit of gun violence and making sure people are held accountable. And at the end of the day, I want to make sure that the community recognizes that we are going to be insistent that people respect the rule of law. You don't like the law, you could go up to the legislature and change it. But whatever the rule of law is, we're going to make sure we hold people accountable for the rule of law.
You've been a prosecutor, you've been a city councilor. What would it take for you, after these two years are up, to consider running for an office like mayor?
You know what? We're gonna kind of dodge all the political questions in the end, and I appreciate the question. But what I'm going to focus on is telling you I think the best thing I can do is just work my tail off every day on being a really good DA.
But I used to call you twice on two different cases. Your mind can handle two things at the same time.
Oh, I think I could handle it mentally, but it's not what I want to do. I want to focus right now on prosecuting.
So you're not thinking about higher office, mayor at all?
I'm not thinking about any of that stuff right now. I'm thinking, and my wife would probably kill me if I did start thinking about
it. If you made the announcement right now.
What announcement? What are you talking about? I am focused on fighting crime. I really am, and that's what I want to do.
Sam Bregman, District Attorney here in Bernalillo County. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.